Okay. Ms. McKee?
Ms. Jones, what we call Craig Jones, please.
All right. Ms. Jones, if you'll come up. So you were not here last week.
Was I?
Was here as a witness. Sorry.
Judge, he was here the whole time.
Okay, I'm sorry.
I was sitting in the hall.
I apologize. Yeah, we just couldn't get to everybody.
All right. No, he was not sworn in.
Raise your right hand.
Yes.
You swear or affirm that the testimony shall be before the court, the truth, the whole truth, and the truth?
I do.
Take a seat, folks.
And Mr. Jones?
Yeah.
Stand your name and spell it before. Craig T. Jones. C-R-A-I-G-T-J-O-N-S.
Good afternoon, Mr. Jones. You and I have met before, and tell the court what your relationship is to Ms. Maria Kinger.
I was her lawyer in some state court litigation between her and Fredy, Alvarez, her brother.
I see. Okay. And
I represented her, and also some of the claims that I represented her own and the son of her by the state was my understanding.
Okay.
But it was just a civil suit.
It was a civil suit and
between the two of them.
Which court was it?
It was in the state court in Fulton County of Judge Eady.
Okay. And as part of that litigation, when you're body representing Ms. Kingery, what was the nature of the claims?
I brought a copy of, I'm going to just look at the pretrial order from that case, and I brought with me because I don't remember all of them. When I got into the case, it had already been filed. I mean, it actually had quite a bit of age on it. And when I got into it, I amended the complaint. I dropped some of the claims because there were statute limitation problems. But essentially, I think Ms. Kingery, my client, had sued Mr. Alvarez, and then Mr. Alvarez filed a whole bunch of counterclaims back. And I think as of the time I was in the case, and the case was called to trial, the claims that were going to trial were as follows. If I can find the paragraph in the pretrial order. Okay. The claims that I was representing Ms. Kingery was a conversion claim on behalf of this state, meaning that Fredy Alvarez was being sued for converting or taking some property that had belonged to their mother before she died, and because she was dead, that claim was part of the estate, was a claim of the estate, and because Ms. Kingery already had these other claims of her own against Mr. Alvarez, the administrator, whoever that was at the time, gave her the authority to bring those claims. Also, there was a battery claim brought on behalf of the estate where Ms. McKinley alleged Mr. Alvarez had committed a battery against their mother when she was alive. Also, there were two claims for intentional infliction of emotional distress, one on behalf of the estate for acts that I don't recall, but something along the line of threats or threatening statements that would cause emotional distress that were brought on behalf of the state. There was also a claim for intentional infliction of emotional stress brought on behalf of Maria Kingery for statements and actions of Mr. Alvarez. Those were the four legal claims. And then I believe there were some counterclaims that were brought by the defendant, which we contended were either time barred or they weren't pled in time. I know, for example, he claimed that she had slandered him. There was a defamation claim that she had brought as a counterclaim, and there's only a 1-year statute of limitations on that. Plus, it was a compulsory counterclaim which should have been brought within 30 days unless there was a court order. So our contention was that was out of time. But see, none of this stuff ever got to trial. He also claimed that she had tortiously interfered with contractual business relations of him. And He also claimed that Ms. Kingery had ejected him from real property, I guess, their mother's home, and claimed that she had also converted some property herself or funds. And he even claimed that she had assaulted and battered him. And that he also claimed that she had unduly influenced their mother. And what happened is we came down and we took the jury, and some of these claims probably would have been dealt with on a directed verdict motion, something like that. We never got to that point because once we picked the jury, Judge Eady took the parties, not the lawyers, but just the parties back to chambers, and that worked out some stuff.
In being unresponsive to the question is, what did he represent Mrs. Alvarez for?
I agree. I represent her on the claim.
Thank you.
I will, what I'm going to say is that I, in further response, I represented Ms. Kingery on the claims that she and the state brought against Mr. Alvarez in the state court of Fulton County, and also defended her on the claims that Mr. Alvarez brought against her.
What was the outcome of that litigation?
The outcome of that litigation was that there was a settlement made on the day of trial, which was actually mediated by Judge Eady. It was reduced to writing in open court, and it was announced in open court on the record.
Yeah. And there was an actual handwritten settlement agreement. I know you have it in your possession,
yes,
sir, but it's also in evidence in court from
Professor
Sears.
Yes.
And specifically, as part of your participation in the case or the mediation or the settlement, was there ever any settlement of any creditors' claims in probate court or any other probate court claims in the state court litigation?
I had no, I made no appearance in probate court. I had nothing to do with the probate court.
Okay. I want to show you what's been marked as M42. I apologize for that.
M42, okay.
You recognize that document?
Just be glad he didn't bring you in when we 41. Yes, this is an affidavit that I voluntarily gave because at one point in this dispute I was being asked to give a deposition. And I offered to do an affidavit instead of a deposition. Yeah.
Your Honor, I want to tender M42, because I identified it as it's on that day.
Did you get a copy?
Yes, Your Honor.
Okay.
Your Honor, I brought three copies of each exhibit, and I'll just read them as court directs.
Okay, I like one, but I think Mr. Spears has.
I'm going to object to the affidavit. Mr. Jones is here to testify. There's no reason for us to enter an affidavit of his that offers his opinion as to what happened in a document that's been exhibited. The document speaks for itself, and Mr. Jones is here. I don't think he gets it. I don't think his affidavit has any bearing on this case. Not that to it.
Mr. Do you have a response?
I do. I might need to board our just a little bit more about the exhibit, John, if I could.
Okay.
Or let that for the foundation, I guess it's better.
Okay.
Mr. Jones, that's all that was in the affidavit. What prompted you to draft that affidavit?
I was asked. At this point, I was no longer representing Ms. Kingery because that lawsuit was over. And I guess it was approximately a year later, maybe more than a year later, I was asked to
provide
some testimony on this dispute here.
Did you understand that there had been an allegation made that the probate court claims or some of the probate court claims have been resolved in the state court case?
I wasn't aware of the allegations. I just knew there was a dispute in the probate court, and I was being asked to provide testimony about the extent of the state court settlement.
So, whose request did you execute that?
Ms. Kingery.
I see. Okay.
She actually wanted me to sit for a deposition, and I offered to give an affidavit instead. And my feeling was that that wasn't necessary because I thought that the documents spoke for themselves as far as the contracts and the record of court.
So I'm understanding your affidavit relates to what you believe was settled in the state court?
And what was discussed, I mean, in terms of what the effect of the settlement and the fact that there was a meeting of the minds.
I'm going to allow his affidavit in, subject to my reviewing it anyway. I don't think it has much weight because I agree with Mr. Spears. He's here to give testimony and bolstering his observations about what was settled in the state court is not something that's required. We've got the state court, the actual order, the settlement agreement and the order entered by Judge Eady.
Yes,
so I am hesitant to believe that this attorney's observations about what the settlement covered or not makes any difference.
It's merely offered to rebut Mr. Alvarez's testimony on Thursday that they had resolved everything in state court and his sister was being unreasonable about maintaining her credentials.
I'm going to allow it, subject to the observation I just made.
Thank you.
You can go ahead.
Thank you. So, at some point in time, did you receive a correspondence about the probate court case?
I believe at one point I was copied on some correspondence of one of the lawyers in the estate matter had copied me on, and I believe that I'm not certain, it may have been Mr. Alvarez because whoever did it just copied me as a courtesy because of this litigation that I had represented them on, and they just added me to the distribution list and actually notified the court that take me off the distribution list because I was not a counsel record in the private court.
Mission was marked M43. Recognize that document?
Yeah, this is the letter that I sent to the probate court. It is the letter dated September 3rd, 2014.
True, correct copy of the letter you sent?
Yes.
Yeah, September 43.
Any objection?
Your Honor, I've got one general objection.
Okay, so please say it.
We have an affidavit, which is not listed in the pretrial information. We have a letter, which is not entered in the pretrial information. We have a lot of witnesses who is. I object to all of these things, and we were not given notice of ahead of time.
Thank you. Without even your response, he is absolutely correct. Sustained. Move on.
Mr. Jones, I'm tempted if that's good.
I'm sorry?
Your Honor, can I say something to you that I think is responsive to the last question of the bank? Being assistance to you?
No.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Jones, at any time while the state court litigation was going on, did you have a perception that you were also negotiating or litigating any of the private court claims?
Not at all. Someone else was handling that completely.
That's all questions I have, Mr. Jones.
All right. Anything on thoughts? Oh, Mr. Alvarez. You first, Bill. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you. Good afternoon, Mr. Jones.
Good afternoon.
Mr. Jones, prior to the representation of Mrs. Kingery, was, as far as you know, represented by anybody else?
I believe she was. I just don't remember who.
If I give you the name of Keegan Fell, would that refresh your recollection?
Well, I believe he represented her at some point, but I think someone else was representing her at the time that I was involved.
Yes, sir.
Prior to that.
Yes, sir. And how about Harmon Caldwell?
Mr. Caldwell, or at least someone in his firm, was involved. I can't remember if they were handling the litigation or if they were involved in the probate court.
And Jeremy Moser?
I don't know that name.
Theodore Erk?
Theodore Erk?
Yes, sir.
The name sounds vaguely familiar, but I don't have any recollection of that had been involved.
Yes, sir. Now, I'm going to show you the document that we previously introduced as Fredy 1. And you have seen the document before, right?
Yes. Yes.
And that is the document that was prepared in state court.
Yes, I believe it's in your lawyer's handwriting.
And yes, sir, but your signature is on the document.
Well, that's correct.
And your client's Mrs. Kingery's signature is there.
That's correct.
And mine is there as well.
Yes.
And Judge Edie's signature is there.
Yes.
And you and your client reviewed that document before the document was signed. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And you advised her regarding whether she should sign or not the document at the time?
I don't think that I can testify about what I advised her, but my recollection is that Judge Edie announced that the parties had reached a settlement, and then he called all of us back in the chambers, including the lawyers, and then we wrote down what the terms that had been agreed upon.
And everyone acknowledged to Judge Edie that they were in agreement with the document?
That's correct.
And that the document was submitted to the court?
That's correct. It was filed that day.
And do you recall me telling Judge Edie when we went back in chambers? You recall going back in chambers with your client, my attorney, Mr. Digger?
Yes.
And Judge Edie being present as well?
Yes.
And you recall me insisting that I would not settle the case unless all controversies were settled?
I don't have any specific recollection of that. I mean, I know you signed this agreement, which was all in the state court.
Yes, sir. And
the state court wouldn't have had jurisdiction over anything pending the probate court.
Okay. Now, let's go back to M42.
Or has he talked to the 10-42?
No, that's the affidavit.
It has been submitted into evidence, Judge, I believe.
Actually, this is the exhibit, so.
I'm not sure it was tendered.
This is the affidavit.
Right, M42.
That was the one you said you're not allowed to limit the purposes of the reserve rule.
Right, okay. That's the one Mr. Spears objected to.
Well, I have a copy.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't have it.
Okay.
I'm gonna hand you M42, and let me bring your attention to paragraph 3.
Yes.
In paragraph 3, would you read paragraph 3?
Paragraph 3 says, early on during my representation of Maria Kingery, I learned that she was in disagreement with the appointed administrator's payment of expenses and overall administration of the Alvarez estates.
So, you knew that Mrs. Kingery was in disagreement with the way the administrator was handling the expenses?
I knew that if she had some expenses that she expected to be reimbursed.
And I
don't know any of the specifics. I just know that there was an ongoing issue, and that would ultimately be resolved in the probate court. It would be up to the administrator to decide what expenses to pay, what not to pay, and that would be subject to review by the probate court.
But your information was regarding the state court, correct?
Or
what you stated in paragraph 3,
I learned that you was in disagreement with the appointed administrator's payment of expenses.
I knew that she had issues. I didn't know specifically what they were, other than it had to do with payment of expenses, being paid, or either she wanted something paid that wasn't paid, or something was paid that she disagreed with.
But that was in the state court of Fulton County.
No, that was in the probate court.
In the probate court of Fulton County.
Right, and I don't even know if it was actually anything on record. I just knew that because, you know, returns get filed at certain points if they're required, and I don't know whether anything was actually before the court. I just knew that she had a general dissatisfaction.
Yes,
sir. The same administrator, I don't even think it's the same administrator, a different administrator was handling the case.
But there was not an administrator in the state court case.
No, there was not an administrator in the state court case. Certain claims of the administrator have been assigned, but those were only those claims that I mentioned, the claims for conversion and intentional infliction of emotional stress and battery.
And there was no property held on the estates of Federico Alvarez and Graciela Alvarez in the state court.
No, that would be completely outside the state
court. Let me bring your attention. Yes, sir. Let me bring your attention to paragraph 6 of your affidavit. Would you read that paragraph?
The settlement agreement filed with the Fulton County State Court only addressed the civil claims and counterclaims asserted by Maria Kingery and Fredy Alvarez against one another in said court.
Okay. Now, let's go back, Mr. Jones, to Fredy's Exhibit 1. Paragraph 2 and 3 of Fredy's Exhibit 1, they deal with attorney fees of the parties' attorney fees in the state court, correct?
In the state court.
And the gestalt of the case refers to Mrs. Kingery and I. Correct?
Yes.
Those are the parties.
Yes.
Now, paragraph 4 states the claims and counterclaims before the state court are dismissed with prejudice. Pretty much.
Yes.
And paragraph 5, it says any future claims that have been brought in the action are forever waived. It refers to the state court, correct?
It says any claim is basically just stating the principle of res judicata. Anything that was litigated or which could have been litigated in the instant action, that is, in this case, in state court.
In the state court.
Were resolved.
Not in any other court.
No.
Now, let's visit paragraph 1. It says, and I quote, the plaintiff and the defendant, that is Mrs. Kingery and I, correct?
Yes.
Shall share equally, that means 50%, 50-50, correct?
Yes.
The proceeds of the estate property contained within the estates of Federico Alvarez and Graciela Alvarez, correct?
Yes.
That refers to the state court.
Right. Well, that is saying that the consideration for the settlement of the state court claims would be your respective shares of the estate. And as I understood it, y'all were the only two heirs, and y'all took equal shares. So once the administrator had paid whatever expenses and costs needed to be paid out of the estate, the net proceeds that would be split 50-50, that was what you were supposed to inherit anyway, and basically the agreement in consideration for dropping all these claims was that y'all would not change that, because the assets that would have been available to satisfy any judgment would have come out of your shares of the estate anyway.
Yes, sir. But it
was a mutual surrender is what it was.
Right, but it refers to the property that's being held in the state court and the probate court. I'm sorry, the probate court, correct? Of the estates.
It's referring to that.
Okay.
But it's, right.
Let's continue.
It's not disposing of any property.
Right. let's continue, less any expenses awarded by the administrator.
Yeah, and I interpret less as meaning separate and apart from.
After the administrator had
right.
paid expenses.
Right.
Whatever expenses the administrator paid, 50-50.
Right.
So, going back to exhibit M42, then paragraph 6 is not correct, is it?
It is correct, because this settles the claims and counterclaims by essentially saying that the consideration for those claims would be the inheritance, and that neither one would essentially pursue each other to collect this
settling the state court cases.
Yes.
Okay. Now, let me ask you something. Did your client tell you that the administrator already had proposed how he was going to pay the expenses in this in the probate case, court case?
I shouldn't say what my client told me. Anything my client told me would have been a confidence. However, I don't have any recollection of that. Although I'm sure that she told me about it.
Okay.
I just don't remember in the specifics. Okay. Nor do I want to open the door to talk about it.
Right. I understand. That is her privilege. Now, that's all I have, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Spears, do you have something on the house?
Very briefly, Your Honor.
Okay.
Mr. Jones, I'm John Spears. Quick question. Paragraph 3 of Exhibit 31, which is the consent settlement agreement, says the plaintiff and the defendant shall be responsible for their own attorney's fees. We're talking about all the attorney's fees in the state court case. Is that correct?
That's right. Because they have asserted claims for fees as part of the bad faith.
Everybody, all their claims for fees that are related to the state court case. Correct?
Yes.
Thank you. No more questions.
All right. You can step down, sir.
Thank you.
Now.
We have no objection, Mr. Jones, being excused.
That was my next question.
Sorry.
Mr. Jones, you're excused.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Appreciate your time.
Good luck to all of you.
Thank you.
Do you have another witness?
I'm calling Steamer, Judge.
Okay.